Good evening, everyone. On the behalf of Team Data Channel Online, I would like to extend a very warm welcome to all of you. I'm Dr. Aditi Mishra, and I'll be the host for today's session on the topic Caste Partial Data Simplified by Dr. Sejal Shah. Okay, so today's webinar is sponsored by Simpladent Implants. They are the importers and one of the major distributors of facial implants in India. Now, before starting the session, I have few housekeeping notes to make. If you have any doubts during this session, you can put your question in the question and answer box in the control panel, and we'll be taking up each and every question one by one at the end of the session. If you have joined us from Facebook and YouTube Live, you can ask questions by commenting, and we'll be answering the questions there. So without further ado, I would like to introduce our today's speaker to everyone. Dr. Sejal Shah is MDS prosthodontist and oral implantologist practicing in Mumbai. She did her BDS from Darshan Dental College and Hospital Udaipur and MDS from Maharashtra University of Health Sciences, Nashik. She maintains her specialty dental practice in the name Vardhman Dental Clinic at Malad with prime attention to smile designing, full mouth rehabilitation and implant restoration. Over to you. Good evening, ma'am. Can you hear me?
Yeah. I'm just opening the presentation.
Right.
So, can I start, Aditi?
Anji, please, ma'am. Please go ahead.
Good evening, everyone. Myself, Dr. Sejal Shah. I'm consulting prosthodontist and implantologist practicing in Mumbai. My topic for today's presentation will be on cast partial dentures simplified. Whenever a partially edentulous patient reports to our dental office, we give a acrylic cast removal partial denture. But this type of processes are temporary. So we have to give a more definite or permanent option to the patient in the form of cast partial denture. Now, most of the clinicians, they face challenges. Like, there are two challenges. First is how to do the mouth preparation. And second is that they are slightly expensive compared to the acrylic removable partial dentures. So in order to simplify this, I came up with this webinar of cast partial denture simplified. First of all, the patient must earn the right to receive a cast partial denture. Because if we don't give an option to the patient, how they will know that this treatment modality is present? So if we give this type of processes to the patient, they feel more confident, more satisfied, and they will bring more patients to your dental office. Now, to introduce this topic, cast partial dentures, they don't just happen. It requires a well-planned sequence of events, and the mouth is rarely suited to receive a cast partial denture. So dentists must alter certain oral structures and conditions to prepare the mouth to receive the prosthesis. It is the mouth preparation. Mouth preparation is a term intended to cover all types of changes effected in the teeth, foundation ridges or other oral structures that may be deemed necessary to accomplish a better cast partial denture results. So the processes must not only replace what is missing, but must also preserve the remaining tissues and structures. So this is the aim of these processes. Now, objectives: to establish a state of health in the supporting and contiguous tissues, to eliminate interferences or obstruction to the placement, removal and during the function of the prosthesis, to establish acceptable occlusal plane and acceptable occlusal scheme. Like, two types of schemes are there. One is group function and canine guided occlusion. So we have to follow the same occlusion into the patient's mouth, and also we have to follow the occlusal plane. To alter the natural tooth form to accommodate the requirements of form and function of the processes. Now, just to revise the basic theory which we already learned, we will see first the basic parts of the cast partial dentures. Then I will tell you how to do a mouth preparation step by step. Then we will see all the designs and then some clinical cases of me. So, to start with, Just to revise it, classification of partially edentulous arches. It was proposed by Dr. Edward Kennedy in 1925. So class 1 is a bilateral edentulous area which is present posterior to the remaining natural teeth. Class 2 is unilateral edentulous area located posterior to the remaining natural teeth. Class 3 is the unilateral edentulous area with natural tooth both anterior and posterior to it. And class 4 is a single but bilateral edentulous area located anterior to the remaining natural teeth. Now steps in treatment of a cast partial denture patient. So first of all, we have to collect the data. First is charting of the dental caries and periodontal conditions. Second is radiographic examination of the patient. Periapical, bite wing and panoramic radiographs, we all know. Third is make and mount diagnostic cast. This diagnostic cast, they are made with the use of irreversible hydrocolloid impression material and they are mounted on an articulator. Second step is diagnosis and treatment planning. We have to evaluate the data which we collected in step 1, then formulate a treatment plan and then develop a temporary or tentative cast partial denture design. It will be a very rough design. It can be drawn on piece of paper or on a diagnostic cast. Third is mouth preparation phase 1. In this, we will do all the procedures before the mouth preparation, like if there is any extractions are required, existing natural occlusal scheme, we have to modify it. Then any periodontal surgeries are required or any endo treatment or any crown and bridge work is required into the patient's mouth. So at this stage, we will do formulation of a final CPD design. In this, we will clinical conditions, they are altered. So we have to obtain a new mounted diagnostic cast if tooth or tissue contours have been significantly altered during the phase 1 of the mouth preparation. And then we have to review and modify the original diagnostic information as necessary. And then we have to make a new records. And then we have to make a survey of this new cast and modify the tentative design if necessary. So if the alterations are many, then we have to alter the tentative or the temporary design which we have already drawn on the piece of paper or a diagnostic cast. Now in this step, we will actually do the mouth preparation. It is a phase 2 of mouth preparation where we place guide surfaces and rest teeth preparations and rest on a diagnostic cast, and then this will be acting as a roadmap to perform the tooth alterations into the patient's mouth. So after doing all the alterations, we will again make a final or master cast with the use of irreversible hydrochloride impression material, and then we will see by pouring the cast, is it okay? If it is not okay, on the surveyor, we have to use the surveyor in this case, and if it is okay, then we will proceed further. If it is not okay, we have to again correct the plane of all the planes, and then we have to go further. Modify the preparations as necessary and make a final impression. So this will act as a final cast or master cast. After that, we have to tripod this cast, master cast, and then when everything is all right, we have to write a accurate work authorization form to send these things into the laboratory. So submit the diagnostic cast, opposite cast, work authorization and surveyed master cast to the laboratory for framework fabrication. And when we get the framework, we have to try it into the patient's mouth. If alterations are required, we have to do, and then we have to proceed further. If we are making an altered cast impression, if there are distal extension cases, then we have to make this impression and then we have to move it further. Afterwards, we will do maxillomandibular relationship into the patient's mouth, and then arrangement of artificial teeth starts. After that, we have to do a aesthetic trial of anterior teeth and then posterior teeth. After patient will give a consent for trial, we will process the denture base and submit the work authorization to the lab. And when the prepared processes comes into our hand, we will give it to the patient and we will set the patient for recall and maintenance. Recall is after 24 hours, and for the long-term maintenance, we have to call the patient after 1 month, 3 months and 6 months. At these appointments, we have to see how the patient is maintaining the processes and how the other structures they are functioning. We have to also see the patient's level of home care and we have to guide the patient accordingly. So this is the procedure for construction of cast partial denture. Now, categories of mouth preparation, there are two categories, prosthetic treatment or non-prosthetic treatment. We already discussed before the main mouth preparation, we have to alter the tissues inside the patient's mouth. Like if any oral surgical treatment is required, ortho, perio, endo, restorative dentistry, behavior science and occlusion. We have to alter this first and then we will move towards the prostho treatment. In this, there are two types, subtractive treatment or additive treatment. Subtraction means we are removing the tooth structure by forming guide planes and occlusal seat preparations. And additive means we are adding something to the tooth in the form of crowns. If the we are not getting adequate retention from the existing tooth, we have to make a crown on the teeth. In general, mouth preparation includes procedures in four categories: oral surgical preparation, conditioning of abused and irritated tissues, periodontal preparation, and preparation of abutment teeth. So we will see this in detail. First of all, we will do, whenever there is a patient, then we will first do is the oral prophylaxis. Then comes the stage of impression making, diagnostic impressions with the use of irreversible hydrochloride impression material. Afterwards, we have to place this cast on a surveyor and decide that in this patient is it possible to do or construct a cast partial denture or not. If there is any occlusal plane correction is required, we will do it with the use of enameloplasty. There will be a removal of enamel, onlay, crowns, endodontics or surgery. If there are any malalignments, we have to do orthodontic realignment, crowns and enameloplasty. If there are any weakened teeth, we have to do fixed or removable type of splinting. If there are any acute episodes of pain, then we have to do first is the relief of pain. Patient must be comfortable for the treatment afterwards. So pain reduction is required. Oral surgical procedures, like if there is any wisdom teeth present, impacted teeth are there, then we have to correct them. Root stump removal, any pre-prosthetic surgery is required. Then at this stage we will do. Periodontal preparation, if the patient is periodontally weakened, then we have to do flap surgery. If there is any gingival overgrowth on the existing tooth where we require preparation, then we have to remove this overgrowth and then we can do the mouth preparation. Any endodontic treatment is required. If we are taking the support from this teeth, endo treatment or any we require extra retention like in the form of endopins, then we can do at this stage. Now coming to the main components of removable cast partial denture, there are 7 components. We will see in detail each one. First is the major connector, second is minor connector, third is rest, fourth is direct retainer, fifth is indirect retainer, sixth is denture base, and seventh is artificial teeth replacement. So these are the main components of cast partial denture. Major connector is that part of the partial removal dental processes that joins the components on one side of the arch to those on the opposite side. So requirements of a major connector, first is it must be rigid, must provide vertical support and protect the soft tissues, obtain indirect retention when indicated, opportunity of positioning denture bases where indicated, and patient comfort is the most important. Now to classify the major connectors, there are maxillary and mandibular major connectors. So in the maxillary part there are 6 and in mandibular part there are 5 types of major connectors. So we will see each one by one. First is a single palatal bar. So it is in the form of single bar which rests on the palate. So it is mainly indicated in Candidis class 3 condition. Second is single palatal strap. It is in the form of strap on the hard palate. and it is indicated in bilateral tooth bound edentulous spines in Kennedy's class 3 conditions. Anteroposterior bar, it is in the form of bar on the anterior side and on the posterior side on the hard palate. It is also called as AP bar or double palatal bar. It is indicated when there is a bilateral long edentulous space with periodontally sound abutment teeth and when there is a presence of torus palatinus. Fourth is the anteroposterior palatal strap. It is in the form of strap on the anterior aspect and on the posterior aspect of the hard palate. It is also called as closed horseshoe shaped connector or AP strap. It is structurally very strong and rigid. It is indicated in cases where almost it is most commonly used for all the partial denture designs, and it can be used in cases of presence of torus palatinus. U-shaped major connector, it is in a shape of U. Because of that, it is called as a U-shaped connector. It is also called as horseshoe-shaped connector. Indications, when the non-intervention of palatal tori extending up to the posterior margin of the hard palate. So if there is a big tori here, then it is a major connector of use. But it is rarely used because it lacks rigidity. And the main requirement for any major connector is it must be rigid. So it is rarely used when there is a problem of palatal tori and we can't remove it by surgery, then only. There may be spreading of the free ends when the occlusal forces are applied. So it lacks rigidity. And since it covers the rugae area, in rugae area also it covers the hard palate. Because of that, it interferes with phonetics. So we have to inform the patient these things, that it will interfere with your phonetics. Sixth is palatal plate connector. It covers the hard palate in the form of plate, and it is also called as full palate connector, complete palatal coverage connector. So it is indicated in Kennedy's class 1 conditions with severe resorption of residual ridges. Now coming to the mandibular connectors, first is the lingual bar. It is the most commonly used type of mandibular major connector. It is indicated in all situations of tooth supported cast partial dentures. Second is cingulum bar. It is also called as continuous bar. It rests on the cingulum of the mandibular anterior teeth like this. It is a type of major connector which rests on the cingulum of anterior teeth. It is indicated in cases where the axial alignment of anterior teeth are such that wide interproximal areas are to be blocked, like if there is a case of gingival recession. It is most commonly seen in mandibular anterior region only. So in that cases, this major connector is the indication. Lingual bar with cingulum bar. It consists of two portions. This is a cingulum bar and this area act as a lingual bar. So if they are joined, then this type of major connector is made. Double lingual bar, split bar, Kennedy bar and continuous lingual class. And indicated in case where the wide interproximal areas prevent the use of lingual plate. Now the fourth one is lingual plate. It is in the shape of plate. This is the inside surface and this is into the patient's mouth. So commonly used in cases of periodontally compromised remaining teeth. Other indications are if there is a high frenal attachment, lingual tori present, when indirect retention is required, when it is most commonly required in Kennedy's class 1, and stabilization of periodontally weakened teeth. Fifth is the labial bar. Here there is a labial bar inside the acrylic part. So it is a type of major connector which is placed labial or buckled to the alveolar ridge and teeth. It is mainly indicated when lingually tilted anterior and posterior teeth, they are non-correctable. And if there is a large lingual tori, then we have to use this type of major connector. Now minor connectors is a connecting link between the major connector or base of a partial removal dental processes and the other units of the processes, such as the class assembly, indirect retainers, occlusal rests, or cingulum rests. Now there are four types of minor connectors. We will see one by one. First is the minor connectors that joins the class assemblies to major connector. So this is the class. It joins this minor connector joins with the major connector here in this CPD. Second one is the minor connectors that joins indirect retainers or auxiliary rest to major connector. We can see in this there is a rest and then this is a minor connector and this is a major connector. But this should form a right angle with corresponding major connector, but the junction should be gently curved to prevent stress concentration. We can see on this CPD, this is a minor connector. Minor connectors that join denture bases to major connectors, in this three forms are there: open or lattice construction, mesh construction, or bead, wire, or nail head connection. So here it is an open type of lattice work minor connector. Fourth is the minor connector that serves as an approach arm for bar type class. In this case, it is not rigid and it gives springy action. It supports the direct retainer which engages undercut of a tooth by approaching it gingivally. Like this acts as a minor connector between a class and the major connector. This part is a minor connector. Now coming to the rest and rest seat. Rest is defined as a rigid stabilizing extension of a fixed or removable partial denture which contacts a remaining tooth or teeth to dissipate vertical or horizontal forces. And rest seat is a prepared recess in a tooth or restoration created to receive the occlusal, incisal, cingulum or lingual rests. Now to show them in a diagram, there are three types of rest are there based on the position of the rest on the abutment. It can be a occlusal rest, it can be a cingulum rest, resting on the cingulum of the anterior teeth, and it can be a incisal rest on incisal surface of the anterior teeth. Functions of rest seats, they transmit the forces apically along the long axis of the tooth. Second function is act as a vertical stop. And third is they maintain the retentive class in its proper position. And functions of a occlusal rest are it controls distribution of occlusal forces, keep class in predetermined position, and also they prevent foot impaction. Now form of occlusal rest seat. They are prepared on the occlusal surface near the marginal area. Deepest part of the rest seat, they lie along the center of the tooth, not on a marginal ridge area. Dimensions, buccolingually or buccopalatally, they are 1/2 of the total tooth length, and mesiodistally, they are 1/3 to 1/2 on the tooth surface. Direct retainers, it is a type, it is that component of a partial removal dental processes used to retain and prevent dislodgement consisting of a class assembly or precision attachment. Now direct retainers, there are two types, intracoronal or extracoronal. So intracoronal means they are inside the tooth surface. It can be, for example, precision attachments, internal attachments, and prefabricated attachments, and extracoronal in the form of clasps outside the tooth surface. So they can be manufactured, like they are ready-made. So example is Dalbo type, and custom-made means we have fabricated the extracoronal retainer for that particular patient. It can be occlusally approaching clasp. The clasp is class approaches the tooth from the occlusal side, or it can be a gingivally approaching class when the class approaches the tooth from the gingival area. Now types of clasp, they can be a circumferential clasp, occlusal approaching clasp, or vertical projection or gingivally approaching clasp. So these are the more commonly used direct retainers. So we will discuss all the types in detail. First is suprabulge or cast circumferential or Eckers class. It is the most commonly used class because it is very easy to construct and it is like can be done in every case. Simple circlet clasp. They are in a form of C with a retentive arm and a reciprocal arm and one occlusal rest like this on both the sides. Reverse circlet clasp. It is reverse than the simple circlet clasp because it takes the it has a retentive arm rest and a reciprocal arm, but it approaches the buccal surface from a mesial side and then rest on the distal undercut like this. So it is called as the reverse approach arm. Multiple circlet clasp. In this, the reciprocal arms, they are joined and on the buccal side the retentive arms are like this. So there are two, because of that they are called as the multiple circlet clasp. Embrasure clasp. It is also called as the modified grip clasp. They are joined by their body. You can see here, this is a body of a clasp, two clasp, C clasp. They are joined by their body. It is called as the embrasure clasp. They are mainly indicated in Kennedy's class 2, 3 and 4 cases. This is a ring clasp. It encircles the tooth in a form of ring. Because of that, it is called as the ring clasp. It is mainly indicated when there are tilted maxillary molars are present. C clasp. It is also called as reverse action, hairpin or fish hook clasp. And because it is like a C, it forms a C. And it is mainly indicated where there are tilted mandibular molars. Onlay clasp design, it is like an onlay. That's why it is called as a onlay clasp. Half and half clasp, where they encircle the tooth half and half like this on the buccal surface and on the lingual or palatal surface like this. Because it is in two parts, half and half, because of that it is called as half and half clasp. They are mainly indicated when there are mesially inclined premolars. Now extended arm clasp, when the principal abutment is not periodontally sound, when teeth are periodontally weak, then we have to use this clasp. It is not appropriate for distal extension cast partial dentures. They are mainly indicated in Kennedy's class 3. Combination clasp. When the wrought wire retentive arm is there and cast reciprocal arm is there, we will tell this clasp as combination clasp. They are most commonly used for extension RPDs when the tissue undercut is below the terminal abutment precludes the use of a bar clasp, like this in these cases. Second is when there is a mesially tilted terminal abutment and when the retainer is placed on a tooth that lies in front of the axis of rotation. So in these cases we have to use a combination clasp. Vertical projection or roach or wire type clasp. Types of infrabulge clasps. So in this there are three categories: T clasp, in that also sub modification is there, modified T clasp, then Y clasp and I clasp. So T clasp, it is used in Kennedy's class 1 and class 2 types and when the undercut is located adjacent to the edentulous area. These are the T clasps. Modified T clasp. The modified T clasp is essentially a T clasp that lacks the non-retentive horizontal projection. When the horizontal projection on the mesial side is missing, it is called as a modified T clasp. It is more aesthetic than T clasps. Y clasps. They are in the form of Y. The mesial and distal part, they are extended more and the center part is slightly lower. So it gives a Y-shape appearance. I-bar clasp. This is a I-bar, like a I. So it is called as I-bar. It consists of a mesial rest, long distal proximal plate and an IBA retentive element. It is called also called as RPI assembly. Indirect retainers, it is a component of a partial removal dental processes that assess the direct retainers in preventing displacement of a distal extension denture base by functioning through lever action on the opposite side of the fulcrum line when the denture base moves away from the tissues in pure rotation around the fulcrum line. So functions of the indirect retainers, they shift the fulcrum line away from the point of application of the force, thereby counteracting the lifting force and stabilizing the denture. Counteracts the horizontal forces by providing stability and support to the denture. Anterior teeth can be splinted and protected against lingual movements, and it can be act as a auxiliary rest to support the part of the major connector. Now, types of indirect retainers, auxiliary occlusal rest, they can be used in cases of candidates class 1 and class 2, mesio-occlusal rest on both the first premolar. Second type is the canine extension from the occlusal rest. This is a canine rest. It acts as a lux seat from the premolar rest. Is placed on lingual slope of adjacent canine and it avoids tipping action in single cingulum canine rest. Third is the canine rest on a cingulum of a canine teeth. It acts as an indirect retainers. And fourth is continuous bar retainers and lingual plates rest on unprepared lingual inclines of anterior teeth like this and placed above the middle third of anterior teeth to avoid unwanted tooth movement. Now this is an amazing tool which is used for surveying of the master cast. It is called a surveyor. To define a surveyor, it is a paneling instrument used in construction of dental processes to locate and delineate the contours and relative positions of abutment teeth and associated structures. This is a stand of a surveyor where the master cast is placed. This is a vertical element with a retentive tool. You have to tripod the cast on this table. Now, purposes of surveyor, it is used for surveying the diagnostic cast, recontouring abutment teeth on diagnostic cast, contouring wax patterns, measuring a specific depth of undercut to decide what type, which class view to use, surveying ceramic veneer crowns, placing intracoronal retainers, machining cast restorations, and surveying and blocking out master cast. So these are all the purposes of a survey. Now the question comes that how to clinically do all this. So how do we take a first step towards it? So I will give you an idea how to step by step you have to do the mouth preparation. In this we require a reshaping of teeth. It is called as a mouth preparation. So this changing of tooth contour may be accomplished in an enamel on a surface of existing restoration or by placing a new restoration. So all the mouth preparation we will do, it will be limiting up to the enamel. It will not go into dentine. Then it can be on an existing restoration. If there is any composite or amalgam filling is there, on that we can make a mouth preparation. Or by placing a new restoration means by placing a crown, and on that in a wax pattern only we have placed our rest or acid or maybe a direct retainer undercut area to receive a class. So to provide a rest seats, establish a guide surfaces, modify unfavorable survey lines and create a retentive areas. So first and foremost is preparation of guide surface. It is done first and then rest seat preparation is planned, because if we do vice versa then guide surfaces will not stay on the surface. So we have to prepare first is the guide surface preparation and then occlusal rest seat preparation. So guide surfaces are two or more parallel axial surfaces or abutment teeth. These are the guide surfaces on two adjacent teeth and this is the prosthetic part. So teeth which limit the path of insertion of a denture. So during the function, during the placement of these prostheses and removal, or maybe during the function of the prostheses, it should not interfere with the function of that prostheses. So parallel guiding surfaces, with the use of surveyor, we have to mark on a tooth. This is a burr which is used for making the guide surface. The guide surface preparation should follow the natural curvature of the tooth, and then guiding surfaces are prepared first as determined by the path of insertion. So inside a patient's mouth, this is a guide surface preparation. Now they are prepared with the use of parallel sided burrs. Now what are the dimensions of this? So length should be 3 mm, it is more than enough on a tooth surface. Width is 1.5 to 2 mm and the position, it should be 2 to 4 mm from marginal ridge to gingival area, and it should follow the contour of the existing tooth curvatures. Now for the anterior teeth, when we are preparing a guide surface, it should be on a lingual side to give a more aesthetic appearance. If it is here, it covers the proximal surface like this, then it will be, we will be showing some metal in this area, and when the patient smiles, it will be visible. So if we place slightly lingually, it will give more aesthetic appearance to the patient. So benefits of guide planes: they provide increased stability, reciprocation, prevention of class deformation, and they provide better appearance if they are placed in a way that they are not seen. Now second is rest seat preparation. In that, it is divided into two parts: anterior rest and posterior rest. So first I will describe how to prepare anterior rest. So there are three rests anteriorly: incisal rest, which is prepared on an incisal surface of the tooth; circular concave rest on a cingulum of a canine; and cingulum rest, again on a cingulum of a canine. So in this, it is marked like this. For the preparation of cingulum rest, we have to use flame shape or inverted cone shape burrs. With the use of flame shape burr, we will mark on cingulum of a anterior teeth on one side, mesial side, and then distal side, and we have to palpate with the use of dental probe that is, it is marked or not. If we are making it on a crown, then we have to see on a wax pattern, and then we have to cast that wax pattern for a crown. Second is the anterior circular concave rest. It can be in a form of like this on both the sides, mesially and distally, or it can be a roundish one, circular. So we can see here on a crown, and it can be done. Instruments are round burrs, 2 to 4 numbers. Third is the incisal rest. It can be made with the use of flame shape burrs. So these are the flame shape burrs, and incisal rest dimensions are 0.75 to 1.25 mm. They are prepared in two planes: incisal plane on the incisal surface of the tooth, and on the labial plane on the labial surface of the anterior teeth. Something like this. It will come like this in a cast partial denture. Now the posterior rest. Posterior rest, they are prepared on the marginal ridge area on a molar. So instruments are round burrs of 4, 6, or 8 numbers. This is a spoon shaped occlusal rest. It should have a rounded exit like this. It should not be having a sharp exit. So we will see it in our next slide. Now the rest areas, they are spoon shaped, thicker in the center of the tooth than at the marginal ridge. Here it should be thick, and here it should be thin. So the dimensions, 1.25 to 1.5 mm thick and wider at the marginal ridge area. When we draw a line which is parallel to the long axis of the tooth and the rest where we prepared the occlusal rest, and a perpendicular line which is connecting this line and it joins the occlusal rest, then the angle should be less than 90 degrees. Now the minor connectors. Minor connectors, they are placed on embrasure rest area. The dimensions are 3 into 1.5 millimeters, and this is the shape of this minor connectors. Here also we can see this is a minor connector areas. Fourth is retainer areas. If it is excessive retention is required, then if it it is more retention, then we have to do the tooth alteration in this area to reduce the height of contour. And if it is inadequate retention is there, then we have to do enameloplasty or we have to crown the tooth. Now after preparing all this, we have to finish and polish all the alteration areas so they become very smooth. Now coming to the designs of cast partial denture, to like show you how to design a cast partial denture. In mandibular class 1 design, we see the teeth are missing. So we will use in this case a major connector which is a lingual bar. Then a major connector is lingual bar, then minor connector is open lattice type. We will use two direct retainers, RPI form of clasps here on two premolars. Then we will make occlusal rest and rest seat preparation on the second premolars on occlusal aspect. And indirect retention will be placed on the mesio-occlusal rest on both the premolars, first premolars. So this will be the design for mandibular class 1. Now mandibular class 2, the preferred choice of major connector is lingual bar. Minor connector is a open lattice type. We will use direct retainers, RPI on the this side, and a circumferential clasp on first premolar. Occlusal rest and rest seat preparation on the occlusal surface. Occlusal rests are placed and indirect retention is placed on a mesio-occlusal rest on first premolar, both sides. Mandibular class 3 designs. Here the major connector is lingual bar again, and a minor connector is a open lattice type. Direct retainers, we will use an embrasure clasp on second premolar and molar. C-shaped circumferential clasp on second premolar and molar. In this case, indirect retention is not required, and the occlusal rest, they are placed on first premolars. Mesio-occlusal rest on both the sides. Here also, distoocclusal, mesio-occlusal and mesio-occlusal rest and rest seat preparations are required. Now mandibular class 4 design, where the major connector of choice is lingual bar. On both the sides, embrasure clasps are planned, act as a direct retainers. Here we will use a cingulum rest on both the canines and occlusal rest on second premolar and molar, first premolar, second premolar and first molar, like this. So this is a design of choice and it doesn't require any indirect retention. Coming to the maxillary designs, here the major connector of choice is anteroposterior palatal bar, then a palatal plate can be used when the if the ridge is severely resorbed or if there is a periodontally weakened teeth are present. A U-shaped major connector is used in a rare case when there is a big palatal tori is present and it is not we can't remove that tori surgically. Then we can use a U-shaped major connector. Because it lacks rigidity, it is rarely used. In this case, we have used two RPI assembly direct retainers, then occlusal rest and rest seat preparations are planned on four premolars. Indirect retention will be provided by both sides first premolar on the mesio-occlusal part. Second design is Kennedy's class 2 design in maxillary arch. Is major connector of choice is palatal plate. Direct retainers are C-shaped clasp on first molar and RPI assembly on second premolar. Occlusal rests they are planned on both both the sides. And indirect retention will be provided by a mesio-occlusal rest on first premolars on both the sides. Now coming to the maxillary class 3 designs, the major connector of choice is palatal strap major connector, and when U-shaped major connector is used, there is we can't do the surgery, then we can use this U-shaped major connector in presence of palatal chloride. In this case, we will use direct retainer in the form of embrasure clasp, and we have to use a cingulum rest on canine and on incisor area. And in class 3, indirect retention is not required. So, both from interior rest and posterior rest, we will take the retention. Maxillary class 4 design. In this case, the major connector of choice is intraposterior palatal bar, or it can be a U-shaped bar. The direct retainers are embrasure clasp on both the sides, and we have to prepare a cingulum area here, cingulum rest on both the lateral incisors if they are periodontally sound. If they are not sound, then we can move this attachment here also on the cingulum of the canine. So these are all the designs of various types of Kennedy's class and for the maxilla and the mandible. Now coming to my clinical cases, where I did two cases just to show you some clinical pictures. Cast partial denture clinical cases. In a first case, a 35 years female patient reported to the clinic with the chief complaint that she wanted a replacement for her missing teeth. So when I seen intraorally, there were 3 crowns already. So she told me that I don't want to cut my teeth. Grinding, she was not ready to grind all the teeth and for placement of fixed partial denture. And also the patient, I tried to convince her for implants, but she was not ready for implants too. So the best option is cast partial denture. So I made first is the diagnostic cast. Then I seen if it is possible to construct cast partial denture or not. After a decision, I moved ahead with the fabrication of the framework. In the framework design, I have used intraposterior strap, C clasp on all the posterior tooth, like 2 premolars and 2 molars. I have took an occlusal rest and rest seat preparations, they are planned. So this is the intraoral view of the framework. This is during the maxillomandibular relationship. After the framework sits into the patient's mouth perfectly, we have to make the maxillomandibular relationship. This is the processed cast partial denture, and this is inside the patient's mouth. So it fitted perfectly into the patient's mouth. Patient was quite happy, satisfied, and she actually referred many patients into my practice for cast partial denture. Now a slightly different case where I have combined the precision attachment with cast partial denture. So we will see this case. A 40-year female reported to my office with the chief, again the same complaint that missing, I have to replace my missing teeth. She wanted aesthetic appearance in her anterior arch, and posteriorly she doesn't want grinding of these teeth, and she was also not ready for implants. So I did a combination of treatment where I have placed 7 ceramic crowns anteriorly, then the attachment was planned, and then the CPD in this posterior region. So Prasiclix attachment was used in this case. This was the attachment part, and this was the cast partial denture framework. So only in this case I have to prepare the mesio-occlusal rest seat preparation, and rest was prepared in the framework. This is during the trial of the tooth, trial stage. And this is the final processes in patient's mouth. So patient was not looking into my eyes when she came, and she was not confident, but after I did the treatment, she was quite happy with the treatment. So this was the final outcome, frontal view of the patient and processes. Now to conclude with, when I started with this webinar, we have many doubts. Now as you like gone through this seminar, like you will be able to do justice towards your patients, and you can give this treatment option, cast partial denture, to your patients starting from tomorrow. And once you start doing them, you will have confidence to do it more cases. So the largest single advantage that cast metal framework partial dentures have over the newer flexible framework partial is that sore spots are rare, since neither the framework nor the plastic extensions contact the soft porous tissues with any force. And advantage over fixed partial dentures are, it is less teeth preparations are required, and in cases of long span edentulous areas. Now the ultimate goal for this processes is, it should be placed smoothly over the teeth. It should function as it was planned and should remain in place by resisting the dislodging forces. So I want to thank you for this awesome opportunity from Dentist Channel Online, and also Aditi for guiding me for this webinar. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, ma'am, for this amazing webinar. I'm sure all the doubts and everything has been cleared. The whole topic would have been cleared with all the participants by now. It was an amazing session. So moving on to the question and answer session. Before that, I request all the participants to kindly put your questions in the question and answer box, so that we take up each and every question one by one. And before moving on to question and answer session, I like to seek your permission to introduce our participants to our organization.
Yeah, sure.
So this is our organization, Dentist Channel Online, with the motto, healthy smiles that do wealthy. I request all the participants to kindly save this number and send one text message on this number, so that you are added to our broadcast list and you are updated regarding the upcoming. The Today's webinar is sponsored by Simpler Dent Implants. Immediate functional loading implantology is one of the most dynamic and rapidly developing areas in oral healthcare, especially in recent times. In addition to the fact that more and more patients can't wait to get fixed teeth, the demand in the COVID disease scenario have increased the relevance of minimally invasive immediate load implantology with minimal surgical and prosthetic intervention. Strategic corticobasal implantology is unique in that it offers immediate loading implants, and Simpler Dent has been pioneer in establishing this science in India and emerged as a business leader in marketing and distribution of corticobasal implants in India. Simpler Dent has an array of implants all designed for immediate functional loading concept and delivering fixed teeth within 72 hours. I request all the participants to kindly save this number, and you can call or WhatsApp on this number if you have any doubts regarding any event, or you can visit our website events.dentistchannel.online. If you haven't subscribed to our Prime membership even now, I request you to do it ASAP to get all the added benefits. Like if you're attending the webinar, you'll be getting an e-certificate only if you are our Prime member. So to become a Prime member, the annual membership will cost you just 499 rupees. Kindly log in to www.dentistchannel.online. Plus, I've provided the link for Prime membership in the chat box. You can follow us on Facebook, Instagram, Twitter, and YouTube. Now, moving on to the question and answer session. Okay. Shall we start, ma'am?
Yes, yes.
The first question is from Dr. Aisha. She's asking how to guide patients in cleaning and maintaining the cast partial denture.
Like it is like a removal partial denture only. When we give an acrylic partial denture to the patient, how they are doing it, we see. So it is same as cast in the case of cast partial denture. So the main basic guidelines are same. So it doesn't require any special treatment of cast partial denture. With the use of home brush, like sometimes there are kits available from few of the companies, we can have them, like for the complete dentures also there is a kit available. So it contains a brush, then some powder is given in that kit, and there is a box. So in that box only we have to keep our cast partial denture. We have to tell our patients to clean it regularly. In the morning and before they go to the bed, and after each food items they take. So like that we have to guide the patients, and we have to put our patients on recall and maintenance visits. Recall is done after 24 hours. Like at that time you will not be able to see the patient maintenance, but in after 1 month, 3 months and 6 months, you will see the change. If it is too drastic, we have to ask the patient to clean or maintain the hygiene of that denture. And also if it is too much, like after few years, then we can ask the lab also to do it, like finishing and polishing. The lab will do the work for us, and we can give this new denture to the patient.
So moving on to the next question. Next question is it possible for a general dentist to give cast partial denture to patients?
Yes, definitely. Once you have the knowledge and skill to prepare the mouth preparation, then definitely you can go for cast partial denture as a PDS2. But you have to draw and also practice on a diagnostic cast first. 5 cases you practice on, and the laboratories, they are very cooperative. Like they will, when you give the tentative design to the lab, they will guide you, like if you have any doubts, and they will do surveying and all the contouring on a diagnostic cast. So it becomes a very easy procedure. But most of the lab, they are very limited who construct the cast partial denture. So you have to be thorough which lab is good in making it in your area. So if you have a knowledge that this lab is good, you can go with that and you can construct. and you have to first decide that in this case, is it possible to do cast partial denture first? Because I already told you, first you have to do the diagnostic cast preparation, then on the cast you have to do a survey, and then you can decide.
So before closing the session, any takeaway note for our participants, ma'am?
I think this topic is not that complex, but because we are not doing such type of cases, we find it very difficult. It is a very simple topic if we know the basics, and after knowing the basics and doing it by our own, like on patients, and taking the diagnostic impressions and drawing it on a piece of paper, then it becomes very easy. And after doing 5 to 10 cases, you will become a master. Like, you can do many cast partial denture designs, because the patient satisfaction and confidence, it is too much, like after giving the cast partial denture to the patient, because it is like a fixed process. The movement will be less into the patient's mouth, like compared to the acrylic one, and the wire that will irritate the patient, that extra wire in normal acrylic removal partial dentures. So you are giving more comfort to the patient. Patient will be more happy, and it will bring like from your part also you feel satisfied. If your patient is happy, then you will be happy, and more patients in your waiting area. So as a clinician also, you will grow. Like, you are giving a very good and better treatment to the patient in a range which is patients, like in patient's budget. Like, implants, they are very costly. If there is a long span bridge, then we are planning very complex procedures and implants and all, but patients, they don't have that type of budget. Then in this limited budget, you are giving excellent treatment to the patient, then patients will be more satisfied, more confident and happy. I think so.
Thank you so much, ma'am, for this amazing session, and I'm sure even from tomorrow I'll be starting this cast partial denture in my practice. Thank you so much, ma'am, for motivating everyone and for this amazing lecture. Looking forward for more sessions with you. Thank you so
definitely
much.
Definitely, Aditi. Thank you.
Thank you to all the participants, and with this we are ending this session. Have a great evening ahead. Thank you so much.
Thank you.